Hello, and welcome to the scriptorium, to the Italic writing room. This is our ninth program, and we'll be working with plate number 11, with a word list. I'm always happy to get to these word lists because this is more or less what it's all about, words. It'll be better later when we can get the words into phrases and the phrases into sentences. But we want it put together as soon as possible. And if you're a teacher working with children, don't go as fast as I'm going, but take time out for what words can be written out, what phrases with the parts of the alphabet which the child already has. Well, let's look at plate number 11. And here you'll notice that the T, beginning the list, is shaded above with parallel lines. Now, as I say in the text, that is put in there to remind you of the fact that in italic, the majuscules or capital letters are considerably shorter than the ascending letters. The cap should not be more than 7.5 pen widths in height. They can look good at 6. They can look good at 5.5. And in the Renaissance, you'll find that many of the examples of writing have caps that are a little more than the body height. They're easier to do when they're short, and when they're even shorter than this. So don't make the caps the same height as these ascending letters. It makes it very difficult for you. The constructions are much flimsier, and they don't look nearly as good as this. It was a printer's mistake, actually, in the High Renaissance to start making the caps the height of the ascending letters. And then the writers imitated that. The earlier printing, which has much nicer letters, has shorter capitals. So let's start writing. And watch the touch and the movement, because this is what the television can give you. You see, you can learn to write. Many people do learn to write from a book. But it's not the best way. You need a teacher at your side. And if the teacher is not available, then use this television series, where you can see the touch and the movement. Then I'd rather that you paid little attention to thinking about how to make the letters, but more about letting the letters grow as the edge moves over the paper. So watch the movement. Well, let's start this word list. That cupped serif. Branching out halfway up, and the E that slopes to the right. It'll slope to the right if you pull it over at the top, then come in with a slight accent. We want that accent there because it is what is left of the original majuscule E. This little accent is that mid-arm. The hand just rounded the top angle and rounded the bottom angle like that, and then came down and put this in, later producing the sort of E we're familiar with in Roman. But that E needs this accent so that it won't look like a drooping C. And then if you join, you join out of the middle of the E. And by the way, while we're talking about joining, let me say that there are two kinds of cursive writing taught in the schools in this area. One is the commercial cursive, and one is the italic cursive. And it becomes a truly cursive writing when you can join the letters. And if the teachers will just let the students stay with it long enough, they will get to the joining, and they'll get to small pen writing. Then they'll have a handwriting. And I would encourage you to work with the small pens as soon as you can so that you can learn the joins and then make italic your everyday handwriting. If you don't, if you make it just a Sunday writing, the letters are likely to be stiff, self-conscious looking, and they won't have the rhythm and the flow of a true cursive hand. So master the small sizes. This exercise is to be done with the broad nib. And I do have some ex-students who do all of their letter writing, all their note-taking with this B nib. So use the B guidelines and the B nib. I'm writing with a larger pen so that it will show up better. Now let's take the word that. The TH combination is very important. You can just lay the slab in like that, and then shift the pen angle. The edge was down like this at a 15 degree angle to the routing line, but pull with your thumb and push with your forefinger, and the edge then is up at a 45 degree angle. It's much less trouble than pushing the cap key on the typewriter and then pushing the release. So just get the habit of twisting the pen. And remember, don't get a figure four in that T. There should be no white paper there. Oh, I'm missing one word, but that you can provide that. What is it? Those? No. Sloping only a little bit off the vertical. It's much more legible if the slope is slight. 5 degrees, between 5 and 11 degrees, is plenty. Now, if you can manage to maintain a 45 degree pen angle and have learned to shift it flatter for the capital letters, push with your thumb and pull with your forefinger for S, because S needs a much flatter pen angle than the other minuscule letters. You see, if you do it full with 45 degree pen angle, the strokes all become too heavy. They're much too heavy. Heavy as compared with the O and with the H. So to make it lighter, you flatten the pen angle and then go back to the 45 degree angle for the edge after you finish the S. Now take these. And as I say, keep the caps short. Don't use the mistaken approach to majuscules that you'll find in the print script or manuscript writing. And of course, that never was used in manuscripts at all. The script is actually an engineering draftsman's letter form. Let's take the words in the list. Now, the names of flowers. That's a little narrow. Let me try it wider. This paper's rough, as I've said, and it pen tends to skid at times. Right. Slowly, the first time you write with this broad nib. All the writing when you're learning should be done not any faster than I'm doing it now. If you speed up, the letter forms are going to fall apart. Go slowly and just watch the edge to be sure that the edge of the pen understands what it's doing. Your hand has incredible powers of learning, and you need to let your hand learn these movements. Pull it forward. For rapid handwriting, we tend to shorten the senders and descenders, and certainly shorten the caps. This F can go out like that, but this can connect and come down, continuing the stroke. So the F and L seem to be tied. The spacing is extremely important. The letters are no good in themselves. They have to make words. The words have to make phrases, and the phrases sentences. We can lengthen the ear of R a little bit when the letter comes at the end of a word. Calypso is a very nice word. Both from its association with Homer's Odysseus, and it's a beautiful little flower that has this name. For rapid handwriting, we often leave the base of the P without a foot serif. Now another flat edge S. We go back to the 45 degree pen angle to finish the word. Daffodils come up next. You may have wondered what we do when two Fs come together. We start the first one low, start the second one high, and come down and touch the hairline. So the hairline touches thin, the hairline touches thin down below, and one bar. If you join out of that into the downstroke and the O when we get to two joints. Enjoy the movement of the pen, the touch and the movement of it. If you can enjoy it, you'll do much better. But watch the edge and this track, this incredible track that that edge makes as it moves. It's a dance of the pen. It's edelweiss. We want no gap. That could be pushed up in rapid handwriting. When we join, the eye doesn't have the overhand loop. It's tough getting two S's to look just alike when they come together. The old timers, of course, for hundreds and hundreds of years had this combination, the long S and the short S, and they could put the two together, and it makes a very beautiful counter in here. But about the time of the American Revolution, it began to disappear in writing and in typography. Today, we can lengthen the first S, maybe, and then come down with another S like this, so that it does look a little more like two S's. But by and large, I wouldn't do that. I just used two plain letters for most of the writing. See, Forsythia. Twist on the upper corner. The bar a little lower than the bar, the second bar on E. Go up and take a hold of the waistline. R was a short ear. And it's a medial letter. Let's take the Y, which I recommend that you use most of the time. In rapid work, you can make slightly more flourished G. It may take a little less time to swing down underneath like that. Heather, with a nice H that has no two terminals alike, non-monotonous H. Don't carry that last beginning up too high. It isn't up to cap height. It's just a little taller than the beginning stroke. Maybe 8 pen widths. Notice that the hairlines are swifter and they take a little more pressure. or a little less pressure than the thick strokes. The slower the heavies, faster on the light strokes. And the iris. I is a difficult letter because it's hard to make it look interesting. What was done in some of the old periods was to put a tick on it like that, which made it a little less monotonous looking. The I, which I prefer, is this one, but it's dangerous and I wouldn't advise you to use it. Practice it now, but don't use it for a while until you can make a very graceful letter out of it. There's jasmine. J being an I that descends in its origin can come down below the line. And I like to pull back a little bit after coming out here with that push stroke, pull back and down just slightly to get something of a lozenge shape at that terminal. And keep to a body height 5 pen widths for a long time to come. When you get skilled, you can write at a higher scale, but not now. And it's much more difficult. This flower, I don't think I've ever seen, but I had trouble finding something that began with a K. Now, the K can have just that simple slab serif, or let's see, the one that's illustrated in the text. You make this curve and then add this on top of it. I'll leave that. Here we have the curve starting the diagonal. On top of it, we put that and then come down. It looks like a very carefully drawn serif. Rapid handwriting, I'd leave the F simple like that without the curve. The lily, rather dull, I think, with that slab serif top. I much prefer one that looks a little medieval with that swinging down. Or it can be the one that's in the text, an almost horizontal beginning there. Don't go over too far in making that last stroke. Oh, the lovely marigold. Keep a sharp angle there. Way over. And rather flat pen angle pulling down here. And watch this counter as you come down and guide this with out of the corner of your eye, and your hand will get these two counters the same size. I like to jot the eye soon after I make it so that the jot will be in place. Straight. If I had a class of small children, I'd tell the stories about these Greek legendary figures out of whom many flowers derive their names. The C could come a little under the R to make these counters seem more or less equal. Many of us will slope letters too much, and if you find that tendency, I suggest that you make sloping lines on your guide sheets, as I have here on the guide line that I use. You see these lines are sloping just at 5 degrees off the vertical, and here are the horizontal lines. If you have difficulty learning that 5-degree slope, put that on your guidelines. I often don't use them, but when the work is important as this is, I like to have a slope there to keep me at the right slope. Now, the peach. This can be quite wide, this serif on P, because of the fact that there's nothing down here in the lower part of the letter, and it doesn't spoil the counter to pull this over. You would not do that with R. You wouldn't do it with A or with K, because then it interferes with the significant counter. Here, the letter's open, and you could do it, and the letter looks more firm as a result. Now, the Q in your exercise book is just O with that long tail, which gives the Q, or lineup of people, its name. When you speak of people queuing up, that's the tail on the Q. But here is a flourished Q that is a beauty, and you may want to write it. That's a very nice one. Leave air in here between this ending of the first stroke and the turning of the second stroke over. This beginning of the tail rests right on top of the riding line, as you'll see when I write the U in. Is my hand doing what I told it to? This little triangular counter is very much like the triangular counter up here. So apparently my hand is following the directions I gave it. The rue is next. This I rather like as a terminal for the first stroke of the R, because of the hole in here. If this goes over to the left, and I often make it that way, I have to be very careful, because with this moving to the left and this moving to the right, the whole letter looks a little insecure in here. So it's better, I think, to have a solid serif on the first stroke of R. Well, here's the large S. Lift that arm. Rotate on the upper right-hand corner, full curve, straight spine, larger full curve, and we lower the bottom arm. And the snowdrop is one of the most beautiful of all flowers, because it's the first flower up in the spring. The little bells are so exquisite as they poke through, sometimes right through ground next snow. In the fall, there's nothing there at all, and you wonder where they've been all winter, because the moment the snow begins to melt, Here they are. How did they get there? The winter is not such a deadly season as it appears to be to us, because all kinds of things are happening underground. The tulips are one of the glories of spring with their bright, bright cups. You get good at this, your local garden club can give you a job when they have a show. And it's nice to be able to contribute to community activities such as the garden club. Then an incredibly wonderful little violet. Let's try another flower that begins with a V.